I have much information for you. I hope my English will be enough to express it. Do you understand my English?
Yes.
Thank you. So we usually begin in this hall with a brief history of our collection. Please look at the third photo. This is the family who lived in this house in the 18th and 19th centuries. And they were a family of merchants, businessmen. The business was connected with wood, textile, and grain. And the father, Pavel Tretyakov, the leftist figure in the armchair, he began to collect Russian paintings only for himself as a hobby in 1856. And he situated his collection in his private house in this building and invited guests to look at his collection first, and then in the end of the 19th century, he donated to the Moscow city his collection. It consisted of 2,000 of exhibits, and donated it together with his private house. So we will pass through rooms which were living rooms of this family, but we will not see the living equipment because everything was equipped as the modern museum building needs. So only the planning. I will show you the planning. Sometimes you will guess about the size of the merchant's house in the center of Moscow. Everything is situated in the chronological order as Tretyakov dreamed. The exposition is kind of history of Russian art, so you will see the development. Now there are 62 rooms in this building, so of course it's impossible to see everything, but I'll try to show you the most outstanding masterpieces. It will take an hour and a quarter, an hour and a half as usual. Follow me, please. Waiting for everybody, and you can imagine that this was the main entrance from outside, which you have passed from outside, and then this gala stair, and Tretyakov met his guests as his sculpture portrait meets us now.
This way, please.
We need this wall first, so stand comfortable. Everything we will look at our way is the oil painting, so you have to stand comfortable to see it better. First, this wall, and imagine that before the 18th century, before the Peter the Great, Russian art was only religious art, only mosaics, frescoes, and icons, and only Peter the Great began to develop secular painting. And of course, the portrait genre was close with the icon painting, and it began to develop first. On this wall, you can see not even the portraits yet, because Russians didn't know European word portrait, they knew Latin word person. And these first attempts to portray real model after the holy face was called personas, not portraits, but persona. And in the middle is persona of Naryshkina and her daughters. You can see that there were a lot of common features with the icon painting. Very light faces on the dark background without any three-dimensional space. You can see that three faces and six arms are situated on one flat. Yes? And we can't guess, is this lady sitting or standing looking at the light on her knees? And Peter the Great began to invite foreign painters and to provide education of our icon painters abroad for state money. One of the samples, examples, you can see on this wall, this gala portrait of Russian Empress Anna Ioannovna. She was a nephew of Peter the Great. It was she was portrayed by French painter Louis Caravac, who was a professor and worked in Russia until his death. You can see that he had brought from Europe such a strict scheme of European Gallo portraits when all the attributes of the power and richness are very bright and important, and the character is not so well portrayed. We know that Anna had rather ugly appearance and very strict man's character, but nothing you can see on this beautiful festival portrait. And you can compare Anna Ioannovna, and in the next room you will see Elizabeth, Peter's daughter. Left hand, please. This portrait of Elizabeth was fulfilled by Russian icon painter Vishnikov, who was a pupil of the previous painter, Professor Karavak. And you can see that the icon painter was an excellent pupil. He just repeated the same scheme for another person. And we know that Elizabeth had another character and style of life. She loved parties, dancing, masquerades, hunting. And you can see her, come closer please, to see this portrait of Elizabeth also, but on horseback in men's military dress, and you can see that she is very skillful in riding a horse. It's difficult to imagine that it was also her. So these gala portraits said nothing about the personality. The same was with the children's portraits. Now look please this small portrait and try to guess how old this boy was. How do you think?
Six.
Yes. And you see the difference is 5 and 10 even. Yes. So he was 9. So you were closely, but it's difficult to guess really, because he is he has nothing childish. You can see that he is wearing real military dress of that period, having a weapon, the same wig as Elizabeth wearing. So it's difficult to imagine that a little boy was comfortable in such clothes. Yes, it is interesting that it was not important to the painter. You can read that he was small prince Galitsyn. It was ancient and noble Russian family. It was important to the painter. And to show his habits and way of life, it was not so important yet. It took Russian painters and icon painters about half a century to learn how to depict the personality, the inner world of their models. We will see it in the second half of the 18th century. Let's move this way, please. So it is the end of the 18th century, and you can notice again European influences, sentimental influences, and the empire style in Russia. You can see that the same empire style dresses which became popular after Napoleon War became popular in Russia, but you can see that they were very open and very thin for cruel Russian winters, and many young ladies died because of pneumonia because of these fashionable dresses. Really, it was enough only to run outside after dancing to catch a cold in such dress in our climate. This is a portrait of Derzhavina, the wife of a poet and the lawyer of Catherine's government. And pay attention at the furniture, please. All the furniture in our museum is not Tretyakov's, as I have mentioned, but the furniture of the same style, of the same period as the painting. So it was taken from different palaces and museums to illustrate the age. And it was impossible to have such furniture in the merchant's house. It is too luxury. It is the palace level. And for example, that sofa behind you, it was taken from the Winter Palace from St. Petersburg. And one of the most popular portraits of this period, the most favorite in Russia portrait, Countess Lopukhina. And you can see the essence of sentimental art here. You can see a young lady doing nothing. She is not reading, not playing the music, not talking to anybody. She is really listening to her feelings. She is deeply in herself, dreaming, and this harmony with nature is more important to the painter than her richness and nobility, because she is a countess. But you can see very simple dress, very simple landscape behind her, but this landscape and her character are connected with the same colors. You can see the flowers and the same color of blue on her belt. The rye and is generally repeating this color and line. And her white dress and the birch trees on the back lamp. And this rose is not only compared with her detail of the dress, but this rose is reminding us about the age of the model. You can see that she has passed period of childhood. It is closed flower, then youth, half open flower. And now she is on the highest point of flowering, and she's just married on this portrait, that's why. And the painter has a note of sadness because of this rose. You can see that it will soon die because it will not flower more. And the same fate he supposed about the young lady, that this period is very short. And she really died in 2 years after this portrait, again because of TB, pneumonia, because of these dresses. You can see all the corner is busy with the same fashion. We will move now this way to the eighth room. This is the first wall of the 19th century, and you can see the difference. After the victory in the war 1812 against Napoleon, each Russian citizen realized himself as a hero, as a patriot. And of course, the painters and the writers and poets were interested in such models and characters. More firm character, no more sentimental and lazy girls who are dreaming, only the heroes. And you can see that Alexander Pushkin is in the middle of this romantic wall of portraits, and he really was a star of this romantic age. He is 27 on this portrait. It was his favorite portrait, because he didn't like to be portrayed during his life, and only 3 times he agreed to be portrayed. And this portrait by Kipriansky became the favorite because not only appearance, not only character, but the signs of the professional activity you can see here. First of all, this sculpture behind him, it is the muse of poetry. Then his traveling suit, it was a traveling suit, and even including this romantic scarf reminding us about Child Garold by Byron and other romantic heroes and characters of literature. And his pose, you can notice that he didn't like to be portrayed, but he was not wasting the time. He was thinking, he was inspired, he was doing his work during these long hours. And maybe you know that Alexander Pushkin glorified Russian nature, Russian landscapes in all, even not beautiful conditions, even in autumn and spring. But the painters of his period didn't share this admiration. And you can see on this wall only Italian views. Only one view of St. Petersburg is on this wall, this one. And you can see that it has much in common with Italian views. And the reason was that the most successful graduates from the Academy of Arts had an opportunity of free of charge practice abroad. And in accordance with the program, it was usually Italy, first of all, with all the ancient classical monuments. And you can imagine how Russian painters after cold gray St. Petersburg and Moscow suddenly realized themselves in such paradise on the ground. You can see that the sun is shining on all the paintings, the sea is shining, and the people are busy with such Old Testament job, only picking grapes and fishing on each painting. This painter, Sylvester Shedrin, he It was such a boundary in arts. We will continue with the 19th century now, this way, to the 9th room. And in this hall, imagine please that this large hall and the next large hall were kind of patio, the inner yard of Tretyakov's house, and it was an apple garden here. And when Tretyakov had no place enough for his collection, he first of all tried to cover with selling this patio, and he replaced each apple tree with piece of ground to another place, and saved the garden and organized two new halls for his collection in this place. In this part of the room, we are looking at the historical painting by Karl Brylov. It is the events of the 16th century when Ivan the Terrible ruled, and Russian city Pskov was attacked by Poland army by led by Stefan Batory. And you can see that the fortress was broken, and there were only few soldiers inside the city. They couldn't defend the city, but the monks from the neighbor monastery organized such procession with praying and carrying of miracle-making icons. And this spiritual support for soldiers was enough to be so inspired that they really defended the city, and it was a brilliant victory, but it is a kind of religious legend, because in practice it was impossible. Karl Brylov, this painter, is famous for his portraits, and one of the most famous portraits is on another wall. Let's see, Lady on Horseback. It is an interesting painting lesson how the features of the gala portrait, of the empress's portrait, was used for the portrait of common persons. These two Italian girls, Amazilia, she's 4 years old, and Giovannina, she's 16 years old, they were poor Italian girls, and they had no parents, and Russian countess Samoilova, who traveled in Italy, took these girls and gave them education and helped them to marry noble people. So it was kind of story about Cinderella. That's why Karl Brylov portrayed these young girls in such a festival manner. And you can see that he saves the characters. You can see that the elder one has such good manners. She knows how to behave, to be beautiful on the portrait. And the color of her dress is such cold color. And the youngest one is very natural, and she is showing us all her feelings, and the color of her dress is more warm pink color. And the highest qualification of Karl Brylov was in his decision to show not the truth, but better the beauty of the world. You can notice here that the wind on the trees is blowing one side, and the veil on the lady's head is turned another side. And the horses, so aggressive and jumping, yes, and Lady on Horseback is too calm, too still for this horse. So the beauty was more important for him and, of course, for his commissioners of the portraits. And now we will go to the next room and we will see Alexander Ivanov and his painting Christ First Appearing Before People. And he had another task in art. Please take a seat if you feel comfortable. And this large painting is Christ First Appearing Before People. Alexander Ivanov said that he wanted to show the truth in oils. So he had another idea, not the beauty, but the truth. And first I'll tell you about the subject, a few words to recognize everybody, and then we will speak more about the technical side of this painting because it is very interesting too. So on this canvas, 5 and 7 meters the size of the canvas, you can see John the Baptist baptizing people in the Jordan River. And Christ, who is coming from this hill, and you know the next dialogue that Christ will ask to be baptized too, and John the Baptist will answer that not him will baptize Christ, but Christ must baptize him. And before this dialogue, Alexander Ivanov, the painter, is interested in this crowd on the first plan. You can see that this crowd is a symbol of the humanity, of human society, different ages, different social status, different characters, and different emotions, different reactions in this moment. Beginning with right corner, you can see Roman warriors, the security on horsebacks. They are only looking at Christ without even stopping because they are not interested. Then a group of Pharisees in turbans who turned back and coming away from Christ. Then the father and the son who are trembling because they are afraid of any possible changes in their lives. Then the master and the slave sitting close to us. You can see that the master is back to us and we can guess about his life. He is healthy, he is not hungry, he is, he looks beautiful, but it is the material beauty of the ancient sculpture. We can see his emotions. And the slave is sitting face to us and you can see that the slave has terrible face of ill, hungry, tired person, and the master treats him bad looking at this rope on his neck. But the slave is maybe the only one man who is smiling on this painting because he really needs this hope for freedom, and you can see that he is capable to feel this hope even without looking at Christ. Then John the Baptist, you can see that he is the only one man who is really meeting and talking to Christ and talking to people to also to believe, because people who are following him in long course, you can see that they are future apostles, and now also very different emotions are there on their faces, and misunderstanding and doubts and so on. Pay attention please at the sketches and studies left and right. Alexander Ivanov had 600 of preparation works. We could exhibit about 290 in two rooms, in this and in the next room. And he had more. So it was really the task of his life. He spent 20 years working only at this painting. He began in 1837 and finished in 1857. And he died in 2 years after finishing this painting, so he didn't know glory or richness, but it was not really his aim, glory or richness. He said that he wanted to give people the truth in oils, so it was not for the career, not for ambitions, it was only his task. And it's interesting how this large canvas was transported. You can see that it is more, it is larger than all the doors we have passed on our way. And you are lucky that before the celebration of the victory in the war, our specialists exhibited the fortress, how it was evacuated to Siberia. So you can see how it can be transported. Let me show you the fortress. It was taken off from the crane, rolled from the large wooden tomb, yes, and then by train it traveled to Novosibirsk Opera Theater. And after the end of the war, it was again, yes, fixed on the wall. And from that journey, we try not to touch it, even during the preparing of the wall. It is usually covered with the paper without replacing, because it is not very for the paper. You can see sometimes and the portraits, you can see again all these characters, and you can see the way of walking. Why did it take 20 years? It's easy to understand when you see when, that he even changed the mood of the model, the age, the mood, the face. And we will pass here. Family. But we will see later more the reality. It was 1863 when 14 graduates from the Academy of Arts once rebelled against this system of education, and they demanded the subjects from the everyday life, but the Academy refused, and these 14 students interrupted all the relationships with the Academy of Arts, and you will see the difference in style in the next room. Uh, these 14 graduates from the Academy of Arts organized the comradeship of the traveling art exhibitions. And they traveled across the countryside looking for subjects for their paintings. And they had exhibitions not only in the capital museums, but also in small towns and villages of Russia. And you can see that Arkhip Kuindzhi, the first landscapist on our way, he didn't choose the beautiful subject. He chose the difficult techniques, you can see. It was the main task. He was born in Ukraine, in Crimea, and he usually portrayed his favorite native places. And you can see that it is the Dnieper River. And Kuindzhi even studied physics to understand the quality of light, its reflection from different subjects. And people who first saw his painting said that he was a swindler, a liar. Nobody could believe that it was oils on the canvas. People thought about any secret lamp under the frame or phosphor colors, but nothing mysterious, only mixing colors on the palette. And you can see such natural moonlight. And behind me you can see the same natural sunlight in the middle day. And on the opposite wall, we will see the same river Dnieper, but in the morning light. Let's move to see it. Do you notice that it is the same river, but from another bank? We are looking now from another bank. And it was such a future, maybe, impressionistic task to show the same views in different time of the day. And you can notice even how the frames changed, because it was really kind of window to see the reality. All the frames are very simple and black. The next room will show us the leader of this comradeship of traveling art exhibitions, Krapskoy. I hope you will recognize the most popular painting by Krapskoy. Do you see this unknown lady? An example of the portrait genre, we also can see the changes in painting. Before, we have compared the portrait with the origin, usually, yes, and now we have nobody to compare because she is unknown lady. And the task was another. Krapskoy supposed that each spectator will think about her fate. You can see that she is not simple. She is young, beautiful, rich, but is she happy? No. And everybody can think about her reality. Yes, maybe she is very lonely because the landscape behind her is separately from her. It is painted with another oils. And maybe somebody died in her family because she is in such dark blue or even black. But it's interesting that she really has her own fate and her own life in literature, because all the 20th century, the novel by Tolstoy, Anna Karenina, was composed, the translated editions were composed with this picture. In Russian editions, we never met it, but it's a good example that she has her own life, not in Russia, even abroad. And look, please, at one more women image by Krapskoy, this one. Again, the changes, because will you situate such painting in your living room? I suppose no, because it is not only beautiful, but it is also very bitter, very difficult. And you can see that she is crying because of losing her baby. And each woman in every country will understand such situation. So this Society of Travel and Art Exhibitions, they decided that the painting should not be only aesthetic value. It should be a philosophical lesson, political lesson, and emotional lesson. And even the image of Christ changed a lot in the second half of the century. You can see that this painting is situated on the same wall where Christ first appeared to people. We have made such circle, and they are really two sides of one medal in Russian arts. If in the first half of the 19th century, in the Romantic age, we have seen how the Savior was coming to people from heaven and the skies were blue and the people were waiting for changes. And in the second half of the 19th century, you can see that Christ is portrayed as a human being. During these 40 days in the desert, he has all human emotions. Before making his decision about the crucifixion, you can see that in his hardly crossed fingers and his dark figure as these dark rocks, all human doubts. And of course, the church didn't like this painting because it was too psychological for church, not the God, but the human being. And Ivazovsky is on this wall. He created more than 6,000 of seascapes during his life. He was born in Crimea, again near the Black Sea. And you can see that he was romantic, in spite of the fact that Romantic age was finished, but each his landscape is reached with human being essence. You can see this small ship on the horizon, and imagine how it's difficult to survive to this ship because it is pressed between two natural elements, very heavy gray skies and very heavy and dark sea, but it is standing like a candle and it is lonely, but it will survive. And the same symbolic idea is on the neighbor landscape in the black frame. Look, please, its name is Rainbow. And you can see that the worst thing has happened with the ship, and people try to survive on this small boat. You can see number one and number two is on the ship. And this rainbow is a kind of symbol, not only the better weather, but symbol, Old Testament symbol of hope for these people. And you can see that the bird is a sign of the shore, not far from them. But of course, the rainbow is the main hero on this painting. And a more typical Russian landscape is waiting us in the next room. Famous, and it's interesting that the painter Savrasov first worked as everybody in the Academy of Arts. If you look left side, you will see the same romantic views as in Europe in this period. Curly trees, curly clouds, and you will never guess that this landscape is near St. Petersburg. And that was the view of Kremlin. Do you see white buildings on the horizon? It is near Moscow. And once, in 1871, this painter shocked everybody when he exhibited this landscape, The Rooks Have Come. You can see the difference. Everybody understood that it was not necessary to look for the beautiful nature, that very simple subject can be very sincere and beautiful and native. This landscape is a good example of very long Russian winter. You can see a bordering between the winter and the spring, and even the birds, these rooks, have come from the warm countries. They have returned to their nests and building new nests, and it was kind of guarantee of a future warm weather. But you can see that it is winter on the ground. Yes, this snow, these birch trees, even the buildings are very wet after this cruel 9 months of frosts and snows. And after this landscape, it became possible and even fashionable to show the simple parts of the country. You can see this road, for example. And I'll remind you that Russian writer Gogol in the same period said that there were two eternal troubles in Russia, the roads and the fools. And you can see that it was kind of eternal trouble, but the artists admired it because it was a character of Russian landscape. And you can see that this painting is also very beautiful. The liquid mass is shining as liquid gold on the road, and it is reflecting such treacherous skies. So nobody wanted to go for a walk there, but everybody wanted to have such landscape in, on the wall. Now we will continue that way, which is behind you. Ivan Shishkin is exhibited in this hall. He is really very popular among Russian children, first of all, because you can see that this painting, this landscape, the morning in the pine forest, it is rather similar with the folk tale about the family of bears. And another reason is that all the 20th century, the picture from this painting was printed on coverings of chocolates, and several generations of Soviet people and Russian people know this painting for chocolates. And Ivan Shishkin, you can see his portrait, this sculpture. He was really the most patriotic landscapist because he portrayed not only the beauty of Russian nature, but first of all the material values of Russian nature. The wood and the rye were the main subjects of trading, of export, and of course it was important. And Shishkin even studied botanics to understand each plant and to show it with such photographic accuracy. You can see this really golden sea of rye, and look please at these figures on the road. They must show you the highness of the rye. You can see that it reaches the shoulder of adult woman. And again, these birds, they are the sign of future rain, and you can see that preparations for rain are on the horizon. And in the same room now, two painters by another painter, Viktor Vesnetsov, in this corner. But it is very important for us. Viktor Vesnetsov worked in such neo-Russian style. He tried to reburn Russian historical heritage. And if you remember the entrance to the gallery from outside, he was the designer of this neo-Russian architecture. You will see it when leaving the gallery. You will look back and see the entrance. This is a fairy tale-ish painting, and you can see all the magic details, beginning with this apple tree flowering in the dark, dark forest, and the gray wolf, who is usually a negative character, but the task of all fairy tales, the idea was that light forces will overcome, and you can see that even the gray wolf helps our characters, and Ivan, the young prince, is saving his bride. And another painting is also fairy tale-ish, but only those who have read the story can understand that it is a folk tale too, because This is Anna, a character of many folk tales. She usually shy, modest, kind, gentle character. In this story, her younger brother felt thirsty and he wanted to drink water from the footstep of the animal in the ground, the imprint. And she forbidden him, but he disobeyed and drank this dirty water and just to be a kid, white blood. And he jumped around the pool, and that's why she's crying, because she had lost her brother. And for the painter of the 19th century, it was also an opportunity to show the real troubles of real peasant life. And now you see several rooms are closed for erasing the floor, so we will reach from another side. Follow me, please, that way. And first we will finish the 19th century. By Repin, Ivan the Terrible, Ivan Grozny killing his son. We are waiting for you. So Repin and Ivan the Terrible killing his son, the real events of the 16th century, and we know that he have got his nickname, the Terrible, because of his explosive character, that he had periods of really aggressiveness when he executed and exiled a lot of people, and then periods of praying and donating money to convents and church. So his explosion, this moment, was connected with disobeying of his son. He wanted to punish him, not to kill him, of course, but he thrown his stick into his son, this one, and Prince Ivan died in 3 days after this tragedy. And the painting was finished by Repin in 1885. So everybody really remembered the real terroristic action when revolutionaries exploded Alexander. And Alexander in the 19th century. But this painting, describing the events of the 16th century, considered to be kind of political provocation. They're reminding about the bloody events of the previous ages, and Repin had some troubles with the exhibiting of this painting. But first of all, again, pay attention how these achievements of realistic painting of all the 19th century are concentrated not for beauty, yes, but again for the shock of the spectator. You can see how the interior is bloody and dark with the signs of fighting in it, how this weapon of murdering is ready to fall down to the floor before us, and such mad characters when the Tsar is realizing what he have done and the body of his son is losing life with this blood, with this tear from his eye. And you can compare this terrible painting with the State Commission. Look, please, this side. You can see to show the most democratic, the best traditions of Russian monarchy. And this painting was really the frame, you can see that it is designed in such neo-Russian style with coat of weapons This is the time of Peter the Great. You can see him on horseback in the right part of the canvas. And you remember maybe that he have reformed all the spheres of Russian life, including army. He have seen regular army in Europe, and Russia before has had army, rent army. The soldiers got money for the state service. And when Peter the Great had a conflict with his elder sister, Sofia, Sofia was supported by the old army, Streltsy, and Peter was supported by the new regular army. And of course, Peter won this battle, and the old army, Streltsys, were executed on the Red Square. You can see preparations for hanging on the Red Square. And there are families who came to say the last words to their fathers and husbands. And you can see that all the left part of the canvas is very traditionally Russian. These soldiers of the old army, they in white shorts because it was a symbol of readiness to be executed with the clean consciences. And their families in their Russian clothes, and the St. Basil's Cathedral as a symbol of ancient Russian architecture. And look at the right part, Peter the Great. Behind him there is a new army. You can see that the soldiers are standing near the Kremlin wall, very disciplined and similar with each other. It was not Russian mind, as Surikov thought. And he even reminds us that the Kremlin walls were designed not by Russian, but by Italian architects, and it was really contradiction between two walls, European influences and old Russian way of life. And we are in the end of the 19th century now, and now we will go to that large room, we will take a seat and speak about the bordering between the 19th and the 20th centuries. Let's go. Talk about this one, and then we will go to the large room. So we decided to stop here for a moment to show really an example of one painter, how the realistic painting changed with such expressive manner. And you can imagine that this painter, Nicholas Gier, was even excommunicated from church in the same period when Tolstoy was. Tolstoy for his anti-church articles, and Nicholas Gier for his gospel subjects in painting. You can see that this is Golgotha. And you can see another, again, image of the Savior, losing features of God and features of human being. And we really can see such a new manner of painting, too brave, too expressive for church when it was a religious subject. And this painter, Nicholas Gier, was from the same generation as Surikov and Repin. And you can see all that part of the room is classical realistic painting, and all this part is new man. And let's go to the next room where the
Ах, ну вот.
So this hall was not part of Tretyakov's house, as you can imagine. It was one of the first buildings added in the 20th century, especially for one painter, Mikhail Vrubel, who worked between the 19th and the 20th centuries, and who was a good example of the demands of the new style. We called the new style modern in Russia. In France it was Art Nouveau, in Germany Jugendstil, but the idea is the same, that the most new, modern, young style. And you can see that the main task of this style was synthesis, the friendship of arts, and Vrubel, the painter, was really ready to this synthesis. He worked in all branches, all materials and techniques of arts. We are looking at the canvas, 17 meters length, the Prince's Dream. It was the play by Edmond Rostand in the 19th century, or Faraway Princess, maybe the translation. And it was first the medieval legend. You can see the main character lying on the ship and playing the music. But the beginning of the story was that this prince once heard a song about the faraway princess, and he called her Princess Dream, and he fell in love and decided to find her, and wasted all his life traveling and looking for her. Now he feels that his life is finished, he is tired, he is ill, he is ready to die, but he is singing the last song for her beauty, which he never saw, which he only imagined to himself. And she really appeared before him. You can see such half magic, half real lady. He couldn't understand, was she a real woman or a kind of his imagination. But he died happy because his dreams came true. He really, even with the cost of his life, but he reached his aim and saw her. And you can imagine that this painting was also repeated in ceramic tiles, in mosaics, and situated on the Hotel Metropole in the center of Moscow, from outside, looking at the street. So it was really the idea of this age, that this fantastic story about dreams come true, about love and dreams, it should be among people, not only in the museum, but it should show people that it is possible. And look, please, also at this Princess Swan. It is following the Pushkin's fairy tale about Tsar Sultan and Swan Princess. Mm-hmm. But this painter, Vrubel, was a theater designer, and he designed all the scene for the opera, and his wife, Надежда Забелла, was a singer who played the main role in this opera. And this fairy tale-ish costume was also designed by him, by the painter Vrubel. All these ceramic sculptures in the glass boxes in the hall are characters of fairy tale-ish operas by we can finish. If you have questions, you can ask me now. I'll tell you that if you have forces and time, you can move to the exit through rooms with icon painting and the same period also. You will see some more painters of the same period on the first floor. And you need the ground floor for exit. Do you have questions? Thank you for attention. Sorry?
There's a famous portrait of Ivan the Terrible, looking very terrible. Isn't it in this museum?
I think that when he is killing his son is the most terrible. But we have one more sculpture, portrait of Ivan the Terrible, behind you.
In the next one, you will see the sculpture.